Hello everyone, myself Shobha from Maharani Science College, Mysore. Today I'm going to discuss about gluconeogenesis, which is one of the important biochemical pathway in carbohydrate metabolism. So we define gluconeogenesis as the synthesis of glucose from the non-carbohydrate precursors. The major substrate or the precursor for this pathway are lactate, pyruvate, glycerol, citric acid cycle intermediates, and also the amino acids. So where gluconeogenesis or where does this pathway takes place? The answer is, it occurs mainly in the cytosol of the cells, although some of the reaction takes place in the mitochondria and also in the endoplasmic reticulum. And the major site for this pathway is liver, and to some extent it also takes place in the kidney cortex. Now let us know why gluconeogenesis or what is the importance of this pathway. You know that glucose is the major fuel source for the brain, nervous system, testes, erythrocytes, kidney medulla, and to the skeletal muscle. It is the only source that supplies energy to the skeletal muscle under anaerobic condition. Okay, now you can ask, what about glycogen, which is the stored reserve of glucose? Doesn't it supply the glucose, say, during short-term fasting, or even when the oxidation of glucose is high, then liver releases glucose by the glycogenolysis or by breakdown of glycogen. But during prolonged starvation or when the glycogen store is depleted, then gluconeogenesis must occur to meet the basal requirement of the body for glucose. This is in fact essential for the survival of humans and animals. I think you can understand its importance if I tell you with these numbers. See, around 190 grams of glucose is stored as glycogen in our body, out of which our daily requirement itself is 160 gram and brain requires 120 grams of glucose per day, and about 20 grams of glucose is present in the body fluids. See, 120 grams of glucose is stored as glycogen, out of which around 180 grams is utilized daily. Then the glycogen stored is sufficient to serve one day's requirement only, after which gluconeogenesis must occur to maintain the glucose level in blood. Thus, we can say gluconeogenesis helps to maintain the glucose level in the blood so that the brain and the muscle can extract sufficient glucose to meet their metabolic demands. That is why gluconeogenesis is an important metabolic pathway. Now let me tell you about the precursors or the sources of gluconeogenesis. The sources of pyruvate and oxaloacetate is obtained through the amino acid catabolism. That is, the breakdown of amino acid provides these precursors. And you know, these amino acids are called as glucogenic amino acids. All the amino acids except leucine and lysine, they provide the carbon skeleton for the synthesis of glucose. Similarly, muscle proteins can also break down to supply the amino acids for gluconeogenesis. Then we have glycerol, which is liberated from the adipose tissue by hydrolysis of fat or triacylglycerol, which is finally converted to DHAP. You know, it is an intermediate of glycolytic pathway and can be used for the production of glucose. Then we also have lactic acid, which is produced by the active skeletal muscle, and this serves as a major precursor of gluconeogenesis. In fact, its conversion into glucose constitute another biochemical pathway, which is popularly known as Cori cycle, which I'll be discussing in the next class. So far, you have understood what is gluconeogenesis, where it takes place, what is its importance, and what are the sources of gluconeogenesis. Now it is time for the reactions of gluconeogenesis. See, if you look at this pathway, gluconeogenesis clearly resembles or closely resembles the reversed pathway of glycolysis. So you know glucose is oxidized to pyruvate in glycolysis, whereas here in gluconeogenesis, the pyruvate is forming or synthesizing the glucose via this pathway called gluconeogenesis. But do you think they both are the exact reversal? No, because you know that glycolysis is a 10-step reaction in which it has 3 irreversible steps, and those steps cannot be used in gluconeogenesis, whereas the remaining 7 steps or the 7 reactions are common to both glycolysis and gluconeogenesis. And these 3 irreversible steps of glycolysis are bypassed by alternate enzymes specific to gluconeogenetic pathway. Okay. Here you can see these are the 3 bypass reactions which we will discuss now. That is, first one is pyruvate to phosphoenol pyruvate conversion. Then second bypass is fructose 1,6 bisphosphate conversion to fructose 6-phosphate. And the third is glucose 6-phosphate conversion to glucose. This is the bypass number 1, where pyruvate is converted to phosphoenol pyruvate. This reaction bypasses the enzyme pyruvate kinase of the glycolysis. Actually, we call this as little complex scheme because pyruvate conversion to PEP is not just a single step, but its conversion takes place in 2 steps. These are the 2 steps by which pyruvate is converted to PEP. See, first the pyruvate is carboxylated to oxaloacetate, and then this oxaloacetate is decarboxylated to PEP. Now let me explain you the first reaction or the first step of this. Now, as I told you, this is the first step of this reaction, where pyruvate is carboxylated to oxaloacetate by the enzyme pyruvate carboxylase, which utilizes an ATP molecule. But this enzyme pyruvate carboxylase is present in the mitochondria, and you know that the substrate pyruvate is present in the cytosol. So pyruvate enters the mitochondria for its conversion into oxaloacetate, and this is the only enzyme, remember, of the gluconeogenesis pathway which is present in the mitochondria. So as I told you, the pyruvate from the cytosol enters the mitochondria for its conversion into oxaloacetate because the enzyme pyruvate carboxylase is present in the mitochondria. Once it is converted, oxaloacetate has to leave the mitochondria because the rest of the enzymes of gluconeogenesis are present in the cytosol only. But the mitochondrial membrane is highly impermeable to oxaloacetate, which means oxaloacetate now cannot cross the mitochondrial membrane. Therefore, here comes another reaction where the oxaloacetate is reduced to malate by a mitochondrial enzyme, malate dehydrogenase. And now the malate can cross the mitochondrial membrane and enter the cytosol. But here we don't want the malate, so it is converted to oxaloacetate again by another cytosolic enzyme, malate dehydrogenase. And thus, pyruvate to oxaloacetate takes place like the shuttle system. From cytosol to mitochondria, then from mitochondria, malate enters the cytosol. Again, malate is converted back to oxaloacetate. So, this is the first step of the bypass number 1, where pyruvate is converted to oxaloacetate. This is the second step of bypass number 1, where oxaloacetate is converted to PEP or phosphoenol pyruvate. This is catalyzed by the enzyme PEP carboxykinase, which is present in the cytosol. and this reaction utilizes GTP and not ATP. So this is a GTP dependent decarboxylation of oxaloacetate. This is the reaction we have discussed so far, the bypass number 1, where pyruvate is converted to phosphoenol pyruvate by two step reaction. First, pyruvate is carboxylated to form oxaloacetate by the enzyme pyruvate carboxylase, which utilizes an ATP molecule. And in the second step, oxaloacetate is decarboxylated to form PEP by the enzyme PEP carboxykinase, which utilizes GTP. So totally, two ATP equivalent are utilized for the conversion of pyruvate to PEP. So the pyruvate is converted to phosphoenol pyruvate, and this phosphoenol pyruvate or the PEP undergoes the reversal of glycolysis until fructose 1,6 bisphosphate is produced. And here comes the second bypass reaction of this gluconeogenesis pathway. This is the second bypass reaction of gluconeogenesis, which is catalyzed by the enzyme fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase. Here, the fructose 1,6 bisphosphate is hydrolyzed to fructose 6 phosphate, and this is a irreversible reaction and is accompanied by the release of energy. It is a highly exergonic reaction. So the second bypass is the conversion of fructose 1,6 bisphosphate to fructose 6 phosphate by the enzyme fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase. The same reaction of the previous slide is explained through the structure here, where you can see fructose 1,6 bisphosphate is converted to fructose 6 phosphate catalyzed by the enzyme fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase. So this is the bypass number 2 of gluconeogenesis. So now we have understood the two bypass reactions of this pathway. The first one is pyruvate conversion to PEP via the oxaloacetate, which is a two-step reaction, right? Then the second bypass is from fructose 1,6 bisphosphate converted to fructose 6 phosphate. And then fructose 6 phosphate will be isomerized to form glucose 6 phosphate. So from glucose 6 phosphate comes the next bypass reaction, or the bypass number 3. So as I told you, in the bypass number 2, the fructose 1,6 bisphosphate forms the fructose 6 phosphate, right? That fructose 6 phosphate isomerizes to form glucose 6 phosphate. And this is the bypass number 3, where glucose 6 phosphate is converted to glucose by the enzyme glucose 6 phosphatase. This is again a highly exergonic reaction and is also an irreversible reaction. So now, as you have understood, the bypass number 3, where the conversion of glucose 6 phosphate to glucose is catalyzed by the enzyme glucose 6 phosphatase. And this enzyme is present in the endoplasmic reticulum of liver and the kidney cells. So which means the presence or absence of this enzyme determines whether the tissue is capable of contributing the glucose to the bloodstream. This enzyme is present in the liver and kidney, but it is absent in the muscle, brain, and in the adipose tissue. Once the endoplasmic reticulum vesicles are filled with the glucose, it diffuses into the plasma membrane, fuses with the membrane, and there it opens, releasing the glucose into the bloodstream. So this is how glucose is synthesized, starting from the pyruvate, which actually utilizes four unique enzymes for this pathway: pyruvate carboxylase, PEP carboxykinase, fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase, and glucose 6 phosphatase. And also, for the synthesis of one glucose molecule, there are 6 ATP equivalents are used up. This is again the summary of gluconeogenesis reaction, where two pyruvate molecules, which utilizes 4 ATP and 2 GTP and 2 NADH molecules, and the output is synthesis of one glucose molecule. So at the cost of 6 high energy bonds and 2 NADH. So in glycolysis, the three irreversible steps at the control point, hexokinase, phosphofructokinase and pyruvate kinase, are bypassed in gluconeogenesis by the four unique enzymes, which are these are the irreversible reactions of glycolysis, that is glucokinase, phosphofructokinase and pyruvate kinase, and these are bypassed by the four unique reactions of gluconeogenesis, that is pyruvate carboxylase, phosphoenol pyruvate carboxykinase, fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase and glucose 6 phosphatase, which means the control points are the same for gluconeogenesis and also for glycolysis, and the rest of the steps use the same enzymes as that of glycolysis. So let's have a quick recap or a summary of gluconeogenesis. You know, the purpose is it's an alternative source of glucose other than the dietary carbohydrates or glycogen breakdown. Then the primary precursors are pyruvate, lactate, TCA cycle intermediates and the glucogenic amino acids. The three essentially irreversible steps of glycolysis are bypassed here in the gluconeogenesis and is regulated via the enzyme pyruvate carboxylase and fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase. Thank you.